When we talk about the fundamentals, let's talk about the fundamentals of testing. That what is testing? So here we are going to discuss about what is testing, why is testing necessary, what are the 7 testing principles, what are the test processes, and when we talk, or what is basically the psychology of testing. So when we talk about the testing in particular, so let me just let you through. So this is basically the introductory part, okay? So let's completely start from here. Okay. So when we talk about testing, so what do you understand by testing, Ahmed? What things come in your mind? Why is testing necessary? What is your what do you understand by these terms? What understanding do you get from these terms?
Testing is like validation and verification of system requirement, mm-hmm. actually.
Okay.
It's a quite a to meet the user requirement and to prevent any defect, to prevent defects as much as it can be from the system.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's great. Thank you, Ahmed, for your response. Exactly. So when we talk about the testing, so testing is something, whenever we are talking about the software system, so it is integral, it is something which is inseparable from the business application. So what happens that testing basically tell us that what defects are there in a software system. Okay, if I talk about the test, it is something very much synonymous to evaluation monitoring. So basically what we do, we run the test, we basically execute the software and we check the results. Okay, so software testing is basically a process which includes many different activities, okay, like test execution. Okay, so test execution is only one of the activity basically. So the test process also include the activities such as the test planning, analyzing, designing and implementing the test. Okay, reporting the test result, okay, and evaluating the quality of the test object. Okay, so why is testing necessary? What do you understand? What do you think that why is testing necessary?
There's too many answers, but from where I work, mm-hmm. It's necessary to save time and money. Mm-hmm. Of keep changing the software.
Okay, that's great. Exactly. So when we talk about the testing in particular, that why it is necessary, so we say that okay, testing is something which basically gives us a kind of rough idea that where the things are not working well, what is the place, or we can say what are such aspects that we need to look upon again. Okay. So that is something that we basically go for, we go testing for. Okay, so let's, then we are having this 7 testing principles. Then we are talk about the test process, and then we are going to talk about the psychology of testing. Okay, so what is testing? So software system, they are basically the integral part of the life, from business applications to the consumer products. Okay, so most of the people has expertise with software that did not work as expected. Okay, because you have already seen these things in your in your professional career, that many times we plan the things for something and it doesn't work as expected. So software that does not work correctly can lead to many problems that includes a loss of money, time, or business reputation. Okay, and even injury or death. So what happens in this case, for example, we are having a power plant. Or we can say the nuclear power plant. We are having a nuclear power plant, and we are having a software. We are having a software which basically talks about that how much the chemicals or how much the radioactive elements that we have to let allow, how much, what is the quantity? The quantity of the things are basically monitored and measured by that particular software. And if something or the other thing happens that the software is not able to, do the things correctly, then what will happen? The things, or we can say the ingredients, or we can say the elements which are very much harmful, they will be added in an inappropriate manner. And if such thing happens in such a highly threat, threat prone environment, because okay, what happens that we cannot expect anything wrong over here, because the threat is very much, the threat is very high over here. Okay, if anything happens wrong in nuclear power plant, then what will happen? It will lead to loss of life. It will lead to loss of property. It will lead to loss of, the business. Okay. So we have to be very much particular about the softwares, because software have become very important. It has, with the digital transformation going on so rapidly, so softwares have become very much common. You know, if we are using a smartphone, there is a software. If we are using a computer, there are softwares. If we are driving a car, okay, so we are having the software for that as well. We are having the software in the dashboard. Okay, wherever we go, softwares are everywhere. And this is the result of, basically, we can say, it is a result of that, how well we have, performed the things, how well the automation, or we can say how well the technique has surrounded us throughout. So in this way, we can say that the software have become very much important when we talk about making our life more easier. Isn't it, Ahmed?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. So what you can do, Ahmed, you can, if you want, you can just, whenever I ask you anything, you can just unmute yourself, or you can just type it in the chat box. Okay. So that the things will be, so that I will be coming to know that, okay, you are there and you are, getting the things. Okay.
Yes.
Make sense? Okay. Okay. Then we talk about a common misperception of the testing is that it only consists of running the test. Okay. Many a times what happens, many of my friends, they are into software. So some of them are software developers and some of them are software testers. Okay. So what happens that when we friends, we meet over there, we basically say that, okay, what is your task? You are just running the test and you do this, you do that. So he tells us, Shivam, it's not that easy task of just running the test. We have to do the analysis that what things will be required for what software. So that is something that is difficult on their job part. So executing the software and checking the results. So software testing is a process which includes many different activities, like test execution. Okay, a test execution is just only checking the result, that and it is the result of one of the activities. So the test process, so when we talk about the test process, it includes the activities such as the test planning, analyzing, designing and implementing the test, okay, reporting the test progress, and evaluating the quality of the test object. Okay. So test planning. So I would just like to know something about test planning from you, Ahmed, that when we talk about the test planning, so how do you plan the test? What things do you keep in your mind, or what is your priority when we basically plan the test?
The software that will be used to test, or the mm-hmm. tools, the team that we will, the team that we will work on. Mm-hmm. And maybe the coverage, like how many the test cases should have.
Okay, that's great. Thank you so much. Okay, exactly. So this is basically this is how we are going to plan the test, that okay, how we are going to plan it, what things, what software we are going to use, what are the important function, or what are the important factors or the criteria that we have to keep in mind when we are talking about the test planning. Okay, so planning of the test is important. Then analyzing, designing and implementing tests. Then comes the reporting the test progress and the result, and evaluating the quality of the test object. Okay. So some testing, if I talk about the testing in particular, so some testing does not involve the execution of the component or the system being tested. So many times what happens when we are going for the testing of a particular software. So what is the first process, or we can say the first thing that we do? We try to run the software. Okay. It is already, it is a very common practice that whenever we are going for, you know, checking the software, so, or testing the software, so we basically run the software. Okay. So some testing does involve the execution of the component of the test. Such testing is known as dynamic testing. Okay. So other testing which, you know, does not require the execution of the component of the system is used. Okay. So such testing is known as static testing. Okay. So the testing also includes the reviewing work products such as requirement, user story, and source code. So when we talk about the source code in particular, Ahmed, so what is the best practice? You know, because I have heard a lot about it, that whenever we are talking about the source code, so is it a good practice to write the code by yourself every time? What do you think?
Writing the code by myself as a QA or a tester or a developer?
Developer.
Actually, no, we don't prefer that.
Okay. So what is basically the common practice? What you suggest, or what is there that is being, you know, followed most of the time?
Peer review after the code has been written.
Okay.
Yeah. Involve some sessions to check the code written. Is it matches what we are expecting? Is there any like red flag in the code? You get what I mean, right?
Yes. I got it. Okay. So this is okay. So when we are talking about, so what happens that many a times I have seen, because I have got the clients from other, when I was dealing with the clients from Tahacom, so they basically told me that, okay, if they talk about the source code in particular, so there are many such websites. There are many such websites which provide the code. Okay. So is it a good practice to go for those websites to get the source code? I'm just asking this for the sake of knowledge. I'm just asking that. Is it a good practice?
No.
Mm-hmm. So what is advisable as you are a tester yourself? So what is advisable? You know, what do you advise that if, you know, any developer is there and he wants to make sure that there are minimum bugs, then what advice would you suggest?
Just do proactive activity like unit test, just to make sure your program is running well.
Okay.
Yeah, at least it's compiled.
Okay. Got it. Okay. So yes. So if I talk about the two things, so we have talked about the dynamic testing and the static testing. So these testing, this involve the execution of the component. Which involve the execution of the component is known as dynamic testing, and which do not require you know, any component or the software to be run. That is the static testing. The testing include the reviewing work products. Okay. So another common misperception of the test that it focuses entirely on verification of requirement, user stories, or other specification. While testing does involve checking whether the system meets the specified requirement, it also involves the validation. Okay. So which is checking whether the system will meet the user or other stakeholder needs in an operational environment. So it's, you know, self-explanatory that, okay, many times what happens, they basically understand, the people basically understand that testing only focuses entirely on the verification of requirement, that what things are required, the specification that they are looking for, the configuration they are looking for, or we can say the special features that the client is looking for, is it there or not? Okay, what the user has demanded, is it is there or not? Okay, while testing is, you know, testing includes all these things, while testing also involves checking that, okay, if there are some specified requirements of the client, it is also being met. Okay, it also involves the validation, that is checking whether the system needs the user and other stakeholder needs in its operational environment. It is basically the customization we are talking about, isn't it, Ahmed? That if the client has given us certain needs, then it is also the responsibility of the testing team to make sure that, okay, if software is working well, it's okay, that's fantastic. But they are also there to test, or they are also there to look after the customer or the client needs. If whether those needs which the client has given to us as an organization, because we are providing services providing services to the client. So it is also the responsibility of the testing team to make sure that the appropriate customization that is being requested by the client for the particular software is there or not. Okay, so test activities, so it's about this term. So test activities are organized and carried out differently in different life cycles. Okay, is it okay, Ahmed? Shall I move forward?
Yes.
Okay. So when we talk about the objectives of testing, that what exactly is objective, what are our objective, why we are going for the testing. So for any given project, okay, the objective of the testing, it include, you know, preventing the defects by evaluating the work products such as requirements, user stories, design, and code. Okay, so they basically prevent the defects. If there are any shortcomings, then they have to make sure that those shortcomings need to be identified and they need to be eradicated. Okay. Verification whether all the specified requirements have been fulfilled. So we are talking about the specified requirements. You know, many times what happens, client comes and they say, okay, this is the software that your company or your organization is offering, but we want some customization in that. Okay, we want that software to be as per our needs. Okay, so customization is a very important aspect. You might have also gone through these things in your professional career when a client comes and they basically specify their special needs. Okay, then comes checking whether the test objects are complete and validate if it's work as the user and other stakeholders expect. Very much important. So when we talk about, you know, most of my friends, this testing, because they are, you know, into the testing only. Okay, so when we have a discussion about them, so they often tell us that most of the time the stakeholders, they change their expectation. So it is very much important for us on our part that when we are preparing the services, we are preparing the software for them. So it is to be mentioned very explicitly that the client or the stakeholder do not change its requirement on the last hour. Okay, so it is something that we have to do on our part. Okay, but if the requirements are predefined, they have been defined earlier, then it is the responsibility of the testing team to make sure, okay, that the test object is complete and validate if it is working as per the stakeholder expectation, as per the need or as per the demand of the customer. Okay, then the next objective is to build the confidence in the level of quality and test object. So when we talk about the test object in particular, Ahmed, okay, so we are talking about building the confidence in the level of quality. So quality, we are okay for it. What is this test object? What do you say about this? That we have to build the confidence in the level of the test objects.
I'm not really sure.
Okay.
Does it mean like to build something confidence for the audience, like the people who will use the system? Mm-hmm. Does that mean?
Exactly. When we talk about the test objects, okay, so test object is something that we are looking for. Okay, the process, or we can say the software we are talking about, that we have to make sure that there is the confidence in the level of quality and the test object, or we can say things that we are basically testing, then there should be the testing basically builds the confidence that when we launch that particular thing or we give that particular the software to the client, then it is going to be, then we should be confident first, okay? We should be confident that, okay, this software or this aspect of the software is going to run very well when it comes to client, okay? So to build the confidence at the level of quality of the test object, then comes to find the defects and failure and reducing the level of risk for adequate software quality, okay? So when we talk about the risk in particular, so we are having three aspects of risk, Ahmed. The first is the risk appetite. You are aware of it, Ahmed?
The risk, yes.
The risk appetite. Okay, when you talk about the risk, so there are basically three levels of the risk. Whenever we are talking about the organization in particular, so we are having three levels of risk. The first is risk appetite. The second is risk tolerance. Okay. And the third one is the risk capacity. You are aware of it, Ahmed? Risk appetite, risk tolerance, risk capacity?
No.
Okay. So let me just give you a brief idea. Okay. So when we are, going to talk about risk. So risk is one factor. Whenever we are talking about the risk, so risk is one factor which is always there. Okay. It is one factor which is always there. It means that whenever we are going for anything, the risk is always there. For example, we are currently in the online mode, then also there is a risk. Okay, what is the risk? Tell me. We are studying on the online mode. Okay, so what is the risk over here? What do you think?
Do you want me to give an example?
Yes, you. I'm just looking for the example. Yes.
For example, the risk of shortage in the team.
Okay, there is a possibility that the team's software does not work well. There is a possibility that the internet might not work well in your end. There is a possibility that internet might not work well in my end. There is a possibility that there is some, hardware or software issues which may arise in your computer. There are chances that hardware or software issue might come in my computer. So this is something which is always there. These are the factors which will be always there. And what we have to do, we have to minimize the risk. We minimize the risk, or we say we mitigate the risk. Yeah. Anybody who is claiming that they have eliminated the risk. So we cannot eliminate a risk. The risk is always there. Okay. So that is something. And when we are talking about the risk appetite, risk tolerance, and risk capacity. So risk appetite means when we are going for the software testing. Okay. When we are going for the software testing, for example, we are running a test in a particular software, and we have made a baseline, we have created a kind of, base standard for ourselves. What is the base? That when we are running the software, we are running the test, we should not get more than five, five is basically the risk appetite. Okay, if five errors are coming, then it is okay for us. Okay, if the number of errors are more than five, then it will reach to the risk tolerance. So, and if the there are so many, if it is more than 5 and less than 12, then we can say, okay, it is well under the risk tolerance level. Okay, but if the errors, or we can say the deviation from the baseline behavior, it is more than 12. Okay, if the errors are more than 12, okay, or more than 15, in a particular software or in a particular test object, then we can say that it has exceeded the risk capacity. So most of the time, while we are doing the testing, we are making sure that the test result should not give us more than, it should be limited. I'm just giving you the example of 5, 10, and 15. Okay, so if if there is a if there is the requirement in such in the bigger software, okay, in the bigger software solutions, then what we will do, we will go for some other baseline behaviors. Okay, so I'm just giving you the example of the risk of inadequate software quality, that if there is a risk we are talking about, so there are three levels: risk appetite, risk tolerance, and then we have risk capacity. Okay, so the next point is to provide the sufficient information to the stakeholders. Okay, to provide the sufficient information to the stakeholders and allow them to make informed decisions. Very much important. Informed decisions, especially regarding the level of the quality of the test object. So when we are talking about the informed decisions, so what exactly we are focusing on here, Ahmed? What do you say? What do you suggest?
I didn't know here what to say, but is it something like we have faced this and this, and you can decide whether to go forward or keep it back in the development cycle. There is some defects or some risk. It can be ignored in the first launch, so we can take it later on.
Exactly.
We are always facing this, especially in the UIT sessions.
Exactly. Okay, that's great. That's really great. So yes, when we are talking about this informed decisions, okay. So yes, we are basically when we talk about this decision, informed decision. So we are having stakeholders here. Okay. We are having internal stakeholders. Okay. We are having external stakeholders. Okay. So when we talk about the internal stakeholders, it consists of the people within the organization, such as the team lead, okay, the main lead. We are talking about the clients. Okay. So whenever we are doing the test, we should perform the informed decisions. We should tell them. Okay, we should tell them that okay, this is something that we are facing, and it will be requiring this amount of stipulated time. So this informed decision basically increase the trust of the stakeholder. Okay. Increase the trust of the stakeholder, and we have to define the and at the same time we have to define the time limits, or we can say the time frame. We have to define the time frame that well, within this time frame we have to we are going to provide the solutions to you. Okay. Make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So to comply with contractual, legal or regulatory requirement or standard, or to verify the test object's compliance with such requirements or standards. So many a times the people, or we can say the client, they basically go for compliance with the contractual, legal or regulatory requirement or the standards. So to verify the test objective compliance with such requirements or standards. So we have, when we are going for the testing, then we have to keep these things in mind that, okay, what are the contractual, legal or regulatory requirements of the client? If the client is working for some, if the client is preparing the software for other region, for example, I'm living in India. If I'm preparing a software, so I'll be preparing that software, I'll be making sure that that software is okay as per the rules and regulations here in India. Okay, as per the governmental rules and regulation, as per the industry standards, because industry standards here in India are different from other of the world, from the other parts of the world. The people who are working here, the organization they are working here, they are complying with all the requirements that is basically necessary. Okay, they are basically going for those requirements. Similarly, when the client, most of the time the software clients, they are from abroad. Okay, they are not from your country. Okay, there is a possibility that they can come from your own country, but most of the time they are from somewhere else, and they basically specify their these legal or regulatory requirements or the standard or the special clauses of the standard that needs to be covered within that particular software's keeping in mind the standards or keeping in mind the rules and regulation or rules and regulation of that particular region. So we have to be we have to be very much careful while doing the testing that the test object we are talking about the softwares. The test object is compliance with all the requirement or the standard. Does it make sense, Ahmed?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So moving on. So the objectives, when we talk about these, it is basically, you know, continued from the first slide. Okay. So whenever we are talking about, you know, the objectives, so what we have to make sure that the objective of the testing, it can vary. Okay. You know, the objective of the testing can vary. You know, it basically changes most of the time. Okay. It gets changes. Okay. So, you know, depending on the context of the component or the system which is being tested, the test level and the software development lifecycle model, we are going to discuss about this SDLC, okay, software development lifecycle. So these differences may include, you know, what they include. So it may include, you know, that during the component testing, one objective may be to find as many failures as possible. This is one objective. The objective one may be that we have to find as many as failure that we can find. Okay. So as possible, so that the underlying defects are identified and fixed early. So when we basically find out most of the, you know, when we are able to find out the more results, you know, the more defects, okay, when more defects or more shortcomings are identified, then they are fixed early. So another objective may be to increase the code coverage of the component testing. Okay. Code coverage. What do you understand by this term, Ahmed? Code coverage?
Code coverage, it means like how many test cases have against code.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So it is basically, yes, carry on. Yeah.
That's it.
Okay. So when we talk about this code coverage in particular, so what happens that it is a percentage measure of the degree of the source code. Okay, that if the source code or the program is executed when a test suite is, you know, running, so the program with higher test coverage has more of its source code executed during the testing. Okay, what happens that that during the testing we have to make sure that, okay, if there are, for example, this is the source code, okay, this is the code, okay, for example, there are 1000 lines of code. Okay. So it means that when we are going for the component testing, when we are testing it, then we have to make sure that around 800 or something 920, okay, we are looking for 80 to 92% of code coverage. It means that when we are conducting the test, then most of these lines are executed, so that if there is any chance of defect or bug, so it will be detected and it will be eventually fixed. Okay, so its objective may be to increase the code coverage of the component test. Make sense?
Yes.
Okay. And another one we are talking about, so during the acceptance testing, so what happens, the code may be to confirm that the system works as expected and satisfies the requirement. Okay, so in the acceptance testing, the first is the component testing, where we are there to, you know, to check maximum number of defects, or we can say defects, maximum number of defects or maximum number of shortcomings. Okay. But if I talk about this acceptance testing, so its objective is to confirm that the system works as expected and satisfies the requirements of the client. If there are specific such requirements, then we have to make sure that those requirements are well covered within the software. Then comes another objective of this testing, may to be give information to the stakeholder about the risk of releasing the system in a given time. See, many times what happens, let me just give you. Okay, many times what happens, the client basically gives us, it basically, you know, give us very stringent timeline. Okay, the time is very less and work is too much. Okay, so this acceptance testing, it helps us in, you know, giving the information to the stakeholder, or we can say the clients, about the risk of releasing the system in a given time. Okay, so they basically, if there is some sort of, if there is any sort of problems which are going on, then it needs to be, then the people of the testing team, or we can say then the organization, needs to inform the client well within the timeline that, okay, you are looking for this thing, but this this particular software requires some more time, because there are some software related issues which we need to fix, so that once it has been launched to the system, it doesn't throw up more more exceptions or more errors. Okay, make sense? So now we are going to discuss about testing and debugging. Okay, so when we are talking about the testing in particular, okay, so what happens, you know, testing and debugging, they both are different. Okay, they are different. Okay, so let me just ask you that how testing and how debugging are different, if you could tell me.
Testing, it's just a testing to test a particular product. Debugging, if a defect raise, to debug the issue, to find the issue, what's causing the defect to be raised.
Okay, that's great. So testing, exactly. So testing and the debugging, they are different. When we are executing the test, executing test basically shows the failure that are caused by defect in the software. While debugging is the development activity that find, analyze, and fix those defects. So in testing, we basically try to find out what is wrong. And in debugging, we basically try to find, we try to analyze, and we try to fix those defects. Okay. So subsequent confirmation testing check where the fix are resolved the defects. So in most of the cases, testers are responsible for initial test and the final confirmation test, while developers do the debugging, which has associated component and the component integration testing. Okay. So, continuous, it basically talks about continuous integration. Okay. So, however, in agile, what happens? Agile development, some of the other development lifecycle, the tester may be involved in debugging and component testing. So it all depends on the nature of the organization or on the project. Okay. That many a times there, debugging, the testing and debugging, they can be testing is done by the tester, and most of the cases what happens, the debugging is done by the developers who has actually developed the code. Okay,